Hi, I'm Dr. Falbo, and I want to spend just a few minutes with you discussing dyslexia. I'd like to give you a little better understanding of what it is, what you would look for in a student to determine whether that student's likely to have it, and what you can do to help that student. If we look at the definition of dyslexia, the National Institute of Health gives the definition that it's a reading disability that is manifested by the inability to process graphic symbols. Now, what's all that mean? Well, quite simply what that means is that students have difficulty processing written letters, written words, all of our symbols that we use in our English language. And it can also mean difficulty in processing punctuation, a period, a comma, question mark, and some of the other punctuation marks. So what happens? What do you look for? What does the student go through? Well, let me back up a bit. Let's talk about the preschool student that's running around your feet all day, that you're teaching at home, all the basic things. You know, when we start out, they're full of questions and constantly they're peppering you with, Mommy, why? Daddy, what does that? How does that work? And let me give you an example. Let's just say you have a simple coffee mug and you set it down in the morning and you're having your coffee. You set it down on the table and you're playing with your son or daughter. Well, your son says, Mommy, what is that? Well, son, that's my coffee cup. They say, I drink coffee out of that. Oh, okay. I got it, Mom, thanks. A day later, you wash the coffee cup up and you set it down on the drain board and it's laying there on its side. And as you're sitting there eating lunch, your son looks up to the drain board and said, Mommy, what's that? And you say, oh, son, that's my same coffee cup. Don't you remember that from the other day? Mom was using that to drink her coffee. See, it's the same coffee cup, whether it's upright or on its side or even upside down. And that's the concept of size and shape constancy. That means that this object is a coffee mug, whether you set it down like this, upside down, it doesn't matter. It doesn't change. It's always a coffee cup. And that's nice for the student because that anchors that concept. But as we go into our educational system, our academics, as we start kindergarten, first grade, we kind of upset the apple cart with that size and shape constancy rule. What do I mean by that? Well, let me show you. So as we talk about size and shape constancy, we move the student into the classroom, and your little boy goes into kindergarten or first grade, and what do we teach? Well, of course, we teach the letters. And so we start by teaching the letter A. We go on down the line, and we'll go to B, and so forth. And as we go through the alphabet, we obey the rules of size and shape constancy that you taught him for about three letters. Because when we move on and we get to the letter D, you'll see that the B and the D, are they really the same character, the same writing strokes? They're just mirror images of one another. So that coffee mug that you taught that was a coffee mug, was a coffee mug, was a coffee mug, no matter how it was turned around, does not fit the schema of the letters that we teach in our English language. So we've only gotten to the fourth letter of the alphabet, and we've already started to break some rules that we've taught. But let's go further. We teach more letters. We teach E, F, G, but as we go down the line, we get to a few other letters like P. And P is actually the same character, again, just turned on its side. But let's go even further when we get to the letter Q. So we've already violated this rule three times and we haven't gotten through the whole alphabet. But it gets more interesting. As we go on down the line, we will get into situations where now we're working with numbers. And whether you use a 6 or even a 9, we have a situation where the writing strokes are very similar and we've just taken the same character and turned it on its side or inverted it or flipped it from left to right. And even when we've gone to numbers, we've continued to violate the size and shape constancy rule. It's no wonder that students that are less anchored in their laterality skills and other skills, it's no wonder that they tip into the dyslexic tendencies. Now, what signs can you look for in your children or your students to know whether they have these tendencies towards dyslexia? Let's break them into two groups. The first group of signs or symptoms would be preschool age children. As you attend to these, They're going to be students that tend to have difficulty learning letters. They may learn a few letters quite well, and then as you add more and more letters to it, they may start to forget some of the earlier letters that you taught them. They may have difficulty with written letters. They may tend to have prominent reversals. B's and D's are the most common, but there are many others also. These students may show some delays in their speech patterns when they're 3, 4, and 5 years of age. They may be slow at learning new words, not just letters, but then the sight words that they are presented with on into kindergarten may come much more slowly for them. And as we move into rhymes, poems, things like that, they may show quite a bit of difficulty rhyming the words. Now let's move on. How about school age elementary school students? Well, in these kids, it's a continuation. They may often confuse the letter with their correct or proper sounds that go with them. They may have difficulty sounding out words. They may have a great deal of challenge just getting the proper first sound in a word. They will often mix up the sounds within the words, so they might get the proper sounds in the words, but out of order. And they may show difficulty separating syllables as they get older when they have to decode and work with longer words. So now the question becomes, you've detected a student that is affected with dyslexia. Where do you go? How can you help? Well, you have to look for a learning center, a doctor, a specialist that is very comfortable with dyslexia. At Red Apple, we treat dyslexia using the latest research and techniques that are proven to help. Some of the students need visual perceptual training. They need reinforcement of their left and rights. They need reinforcement of all these graphic symbols. Other students need phonemic awareness training. This is phonics-based training in a very intense setting that's enjoyable but intense. We use multi-sensory instruction. We get the students' tactile sense, sight, hearing, all three of these senses involved in the instructional manner in which we teach. And gradually, over months, we can take these students and turn them around. It's a beautiful thing, but it takes work. It takes consistency. It takes the backing of the parent, of the teacher, and of the learning center. Now, there's no doubt you're going to have questions after listening to this video. I welcome your questions. Go directly to our website, type in the into the contact form, and send your questions over to me. Give me a call. I might not be able to get right back to you, but... Now, there's no doubt with this information I've just given you that you're going to have further questions. I welcome your questions. Send them to me by contacting me through our website or call directly on the telephone, and I'll be sure to get back to you.